I've always thought of myself first and foremost as a songwriter, and I always knew that I had it in me to write a number one song. I always knew that it was going to happen. I just wasn't sure when. John Lennon once said, be careful what you wish for, because it'll happen. And I remember, you know, right through the 80s, I just had that. I used to go to bed at night, and I used to just wish to have some sort of success as a songwriter. For years, when I went to bed, it was my little, some people say prayers. I just used to have this vision of me at the top of the charts, or having written a song that was at the top of the charts. And, you know, I'm a great believer that what you think and what you desire actually can happen. You know, anything is possible. The best piece of advice I think I was ever given was in a friendly conversation with Neil Finn in 1990, when I was living next door to Neil and Sharon in Melbourne. And I was going through a bit of stuff with Mushroom Records then, you know, things weren't going that well. And I remember Neil Finn saying to me, you know, you really, really need to be into this, not just 100%, you need to be into it 120%. You have to sacrifice pretty much everything to get somewhere in the music industry. And having seen him, how hard he worked over that 2-year period when we were living next door to him, I just thought, yeah, that's pretty staunch advice. And it kind of changed the way I thought about where my career was going, because I really didn't think I had, you know, I think I was probably only giving 95%, and it's not enough. You have to have that that self-sacrifice in the music industry. It has to be absolutely everything, otherwise you don't get anywhere. And it was him saying that just, changed the course of my life. So yeah, that was pretty intense information to receive from someone as amazing as Neil Finn. I was born in Barnet, North London, in 1960, and my family actually moved to a little place north of Barnet in Hertfordshire called Potter's Bar. My dad was an engineer, and he worked for a company in Barnet called Barnet Instruments, and they used to make pressure gauges. And in 1966 he got offered a job in New Zealand with a company here called Telfirm Instruments, which was like a sister company, I guess, over here. And Dad just thought, why not? So at the age of, he would have been about 36, at the age of 36, he shipped the young family out to New Zealand out for a new adventure. I was 5, almost 6. So that's how we, the Morris family, came to be in New Zealand. It was 3 days before England won the Football World Cup. No, we arrived July the 27th, 1966. When we got here, I just remember the sky, the blueness of the sky, and also the trolley buses in those days, which Ian, my brother and I used to call trolley coaches for some reason. Funny little things like that. I remember the blue of the sky and the green of the trees. It was, you know, London's a dull place, you know, so that was... It was something that I remember quite vividly, and just not many people, not many cars on the road. It was cool. At school, even from an early age, we sang a lot of hymns. You know, especially at primary school, we did a lot of choir singing, and most of that stuff was in church. And so I was, you know, that was something that was kind of instilled in me from a very early age, that idea of singing together and in harmony. And the nuns always used to split us up, and you know, you'll sing this part, and then you'll sing that part, and then you'll sing that part. And that happened in class too. I have this vivid memory of us doing Michael Row the Boat Ashore in three parts, you know. So I guess that music thing was there right through school. Because, and again, when I went to Sacred Heart in first form, it was the same. We seemed to be singing all the time, even in class and especially at assemblies. You'd get the whole school singing these songs. And when I first started there, in first form, it's a long time ago, 1972, I remember some of the first assemblies there. There was this guy called Ivan Ganaway, who was the music teacher. And he used to get us singing stuff like "Hey, Mr. Tambourine Man," and these bizarre songs that they used to make us sing. You know, "Men of Heart," what was it called? "Men of Heart, look away from sleeping." You know, when you've got 1,000 boys singing that, it's just awesome. When I got to fifth form, I auditioned for Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat. You know, I really loved Superstar. And we did a lot of those songs at school. And so when this, you know, Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat came around, I thought, oh, yeah, I'd quite like to be in that. I'd never been in the, in a production like that. I'd done a lot of stuff at Cubs and Scouts, and I'd, you know, done gang shows and stuff like that when I was a younger, and loved that too. You know, having a bunch of Boy Scouts singing, you know, "We're riding along on the crest of a wave and the sun is in the sky." I loved all that stuff. And Ian and I always used to do solo spots as well, or duo spots together. But yeah, anyway, I auditioned for Joseph and got the part of Joseph, because I was 15 and my voice hadn't broken yet. So they gave me the part of Joseph, and that was intense. You know, that was 3 months solid rehearsal. I think we only did about four or five shows in the assembly hall, and that was huge. That was a really defining moment, because, you know, it's a big part, that Joseph part, and some of those songs are quite difficult. I still have vivid memories of standing up in the spotlight, you know. "Close every door to me," and just having people kind of, you know, all their attention was on me, and I just loved it. There's a certain power to that, and having that spotlight and knowing that the rest of there's no one else on the stage with you, you know, I just, wow, it was quite. Quite a massive moment. I remember it. I can still picture it. My house, or the Morris house, was always full of music. My sister Dorothy is she's 10 years older than me. So when the Beatles broke in 1963, she was 12. So she bought all those Beatles singles. We had one of those classic record players where you got the 6 singles, the 45s, and you stack them up and they'd play one after each other, you know. And then you turn them over and play the B-sides. So the house was always full of, you know, the Beatles and Herman's Hermits and Donovan and, the Bee Gees and, you know, the Stones. So the house was always full of music. My mum and dad were, you know, they were typical adults of that era, I suppose. You know, Dad always liked Frank Sinatra and Perry Como and Andy Williams, and Mum liked people like Roger Whittaker and The Seekers and Nana Mouskouri and Engelbert. She loved Engelbert Humperdinck. So that was what they listened to. And then as I got a little bit older, when we got to New Zealand, because my brother Ian was just, you know, like 3.5 years older than me, through the late 60s and into the early 70s, his record collection was just superb. You know, I mean, he turned me on to stuff like The Guess Who and Steely Dan and The Faces and Alice Cooper and, you know, all that stuff, you know. I was more into, I was more into the poppy thing. I wanted to be Donny Osmond for a little while, and I think I probably did become him later in life. I like David Cassidy and the Partridge Family, and I love Donny Osmond and Michael Jackson and the Cowsills, but I also like rockier stuff as well. Ian and I had this, you know, we had a song that we used to do called Walk With Me, which was a Seekers song that we used to sing at gang shows, and you know, we could make people weep. You know, it was a really powerful thing. It's a very sad song, you know. And the other one that I liked to do was Where Is Love, which was from Oliver, which I still think is one of the most beautiful songs that's ever been written. And I well up just thinking about it. You know, it's such a beautiful song. And I remember singing it at one of these gang shows, and you know, I was crying, you know. I had so much emotion around it, and I was looking into the front rows, and there were old ladies in the front crying. And I thought, wow, this is cool. I can make people cry. This is cool. So there's a certain power in that. I like it. My last year at school, second to last year at school, I was in a band called Gnome, and we won the band section singing, you know, we did Space Oddity. And again, it was that feeling of being on stage in front of all these people, and just, it was a great feeling, fantastic feeling. So yeah, music was huge at Sacred Heart, massive. When you think of all the amazing musicians that came out of that school, it's no wonder really. In 1987, I was living in with a good friend of mine, Paul Lightfoot, and his wife in Richmond Road in Grey Lynn. I had a little, you know, kind of bedsit out the back of their house, and I'd had this big fight with my girlfriend, Rebecca, her name was, and she took off. It was like, you know, she kind of disappeared for a few days, and I knew I was in big trouble, you know. So I thought, oh, I can't be bothered with the fallout of this. What I'll do is I'll write a really nice song and play it to her when she gets back. So that's kind of where Nobody Else came from. And I wrote the music really quickly. It was a country song, actually. It was actually a country song. And I wrote the music really quickly. And I remember I wrote it, and I had a little four-track recorder. I, you know, always had a four-track on hand to capture these demos of songs and ideas and stuff. And I worked on the musical side of stuff. You know, put a drum beat down, and the guitar was always very strong. You know, the little guitar bits that I play. And I didn't quite have the melody. And I went off to play a gig that night with my mates from the Narcs, who I was in a band with them at that time called the Rocking Love Gods. And coming back from that gig at like 2 o'clock in the morning, the melody and all the lyrics just came into my head. It was like, I couldn't get home quick enough. It was like, oh, I've got to capture these ideas. And I remember going into my little bedsit, and I didn't want to sing at the top of my voice. It was 3 o'clock in the morning. So I played back what I'd kind of recorded that day, and I sang into my mic, you know, I know I've acted badly, like really, really quietly, so no one would hear. And I went to bed, went to sleep, woke up the next day, and I listened back, and I thought, wow, that's such a great effect, because the vocals were really quiet and whispery. And so I re-recorded the vocals that way, like really, really quietly, and like I was in the Bee Gees or something, you know. And anyway, I just finished it, mixed it. Didn't think anything of it. But at that stage, my brother Ian was in Wellington, and he'd set up a studio there with a couple of friends of his, Jim Hall and Steve Robinson and Kelly Blood, and they had this thing called Soundtracks, and they were doing jingles and TV ads, and you know. So I'd started sending demos down to Ian just to get a bit of feedback, you know, some sort of a feedback from him. And I remember he rang me one night and went, holy hell, Nobody Else, you know. that is a hit single. I couldn't hear it, you know, I just thought it was just one of a batch of songs that I'd written. And he said, that song, you've got to get down here, we're going to record it. Not because we were going to release it or anything, but just because, you know, we hadn't really done anything together, apart from him producing an old Crocodile single that I was involved in called Hello Girl, like in 1981. So we went down and we, over the course of a weekend, we recorded the basics of Nobody Else. I remember when I did the lead vocal for it, you know, I had no idea how I was supposed to approach it. And I remember Ian just saying to me in the studio, just sing it like you really mean it. And I tried to do that, I tried to convey that feeling that it was really coming from the heart. And I wish I could have bottled that feeling because it's really hard to do that. But I was so naive that I was able to do it. And I think I, you know, we really got that lump in the throat thing with that song. And it touched people. And I know a lot of people who have said that, you know, even now when they hear it, you know, it brings a lump to their throat. And I went back to Auckland. I was working as a painter and decorator in those days. And I went back to work, you know, never thought anything of it. And then just after Nobody Else was recorded, Ian, under the guise of Tex Pistol, released The Game of Love. Again, just for something to do. And lo and behold, that song went to number one. And all of a sudden, he kind of needed a follow-up. And Nobody Else was just sitting there. So over the course of that next year, he added stuff. I went back down and added some guitars and some backing vocals and some keyboards and that sort of stuff, and he kept working away and working away. He kind of wrote and added this whole solo section to the song, you know, and a year after The Game of Love, a year after we'd recorded Nobody Else initially, we released Nobody Else as Tex Pistol with Rikki Morris, because we weren't quite sure how we were going to do it, but because Tex Pistol had a name and he'd had a number one single, we thought, well, that's one way of getting to radio, is at least they know who Tex Pistol is. We were lucky that we had the up-and-coming young filmmaker Paul Middleditch do our clip. He'd done the clip for The Game of Love as well, and you know, back in those days, it's hard for people to understand now, but in the late 80s, there was no such thing as New Zealand On Air funding or anything like that. People paid for their own videos. And I remember, you know, Trevor Reakey from Pagan Records, who released The Game of Love and Nobody Else, and a bunch of other brilliant singles around that time and albums. We had a budget of, I think it cost $6,000 to do this video, and Trevor put up half of that, which was very kind of him, and the rest was me and Ian. You know, we kind of split the costs. And I flew down to Wellington, and we went to Avalon, Studio 8, was it called Studio 8? I think that's what it was called, where, you know, Wheel of Fortune and all those great TV shows were filmed, and that's where we shot the video for Nobody Else. It was done on 35mm, which was, you know, which was film, basically. So it had that really lovely grainy look to it. It wasn't so much grainy, it had the depth, didn't it? I'm not much of a film person, but it just looks amazing.
Yeah.
Because the clip looked so fantastic, it was sent to the one and only TV show where you could actually get your clip played, and that was Radio with Pictures. Dick Driver was doing the was presenting in those days, and I remember he put the clip on first. It was the first clip off the rank, so. Most of the industry and musicians and whoever, radio, TV, whoever it was, used to watch Radio Pictures because it was literally the only thing on TV that you could see new clips. So it had a real impact, I remember that. Had a real impact, and because it was such a great clip for the times and such a different sounding song for the times, it really made an impact. And radio out of Auckland and Wellington, started playing it. And I did the rounds of all the record shops and all that sort of stuff, and I knew the guy who ran Sound's CD store, well, record store, I don't think CD, yeah, did they? Yeah, CDs were out then, of course they were. Sound's record store in Queen Street, which was the record store. I knew the guy who managed it, a guy called Steve Maurice, really neat guy. And he kind of came on board and said, well, you know, I'll stock 500 of these and because I'm convinced that we're going to sell them. And of course, as soon as he bought in 500, when all the other shops around the country saw that Sounds and Megastore and Queen Street had bought 500 singles, all the other stores started buying in. And it just gained this momentum, you know. And because Steve had bought in 500 singles, it edged into the charts, you know, number 49 or something. Then the next week it was number 41, and then the video was shown and radio started to play it. And over that next week it went from number 41 to number 11. It just leapt into the top 20 and just got this momentum. As Neil Finn would say, all the planets aligned. remember him saying that once in about don't dream it's over. It's like once that snowball effect happens, it's pretty hard to stop it. And you know, once it got into the top 20, then it was getting played on Ready to Roll, which was the top 20 TV show, which was prime time on a Saturday. You know, so it just had this natural kind of snowball effect, and it over the course of the next month, it went right through. It was sitting at number two for a couple of weeks, I think. And at that stage in my life, I was working for my dad's second wife, Jean, in her gift basket shop in Hunter's Corner. I was helping her manage this gift basket shop in Hunter's Corner here in Auckland. And I remember my dad and Jean and I were having lunch one day at Dialer Gift Basket in Hunter's Corner. And the phone rang, and it was Trevor Rikki, and you know, he said, the song's gone to number one. So from that moment on, really, life was never the same again. It only stayed at number one for a week because U2 released Desire, and it just bumped straight off. So it went back to number two the next week, but it was in the top 10 for about another 5 or 6 weeks. So it had legs. I was 28 when that happened. So I was quite old, really, when it comes to, when you think that, you know, when the Beatles broke up, when they broke up, George was only 27, you know? I just think I probably came to it quite late, but it certainly changed my life forever. And it was a dream come true, you know? I was very proud of the fact that that I'd written such a great song, and that it just sounded great on the radio. It just sounded brilliant on the radio. I think that's why it was such a big hit. It's that full circle thing of, you know, being in the Cubs and the Scouts at the gang show and seeing those ladies crying when I was singing, you know, Where Is Love, and being able to, you know, 20 years later, however long later, being able to convey that in one of my own songs, and really making people feel vulnerable and, you know, feel sad or feel happy, whatever it might be. You know, I just remember that feeling of, again, it's a very powerful feeling, and no one can take it away from me. You know, it's there. I had a number one hit, and okay, it might only be one, but I did it. I did it. It's a great thing. It's like, you know, I liken it to being a footballer and maybe, you know, being in an FA Cup winning side or something. You know, okay, it might only happen once, but no one can ever take that away from you. You know, it's on the toilet wall. I've got it framed. I've got the, you know, that particular week's chart framed in my toilet. You know, yes, I've made it. Well, Everest came about after I'd been in Melbourne for a couple of years. I got signed with Mushroom over there, Mushroom Music initially as a publishing deal, and then with Mushroom Records. And it kind of ended up a bit sour, and I got dumped from the label and all that. You know, it wasn't a nice time, to be honest, but it was a great learning experience for me. So I came back to New Zealand and I just became a working musician. You know, I kind of had to go out and find some gigs, and I was playing a lot of bars and pubs and a bit of corporate work, and I was playing at a party. I remember it vividly. I was playing at a party, and Eddie Rayner and his family had just decided to come back to New Zealand to live, and it was a party for some mutual friends of ours, and they wanted me to sing some of my stuff, and you know, some covers, just as a party band, you know, or party guy. And I was just playing solo with an acoustic guitar, that acoustic guitar, in fact. And I started playing all these songs that I'd been writing over the years, you know, songs like World Stand Still and Heartbroke, and some newer ones like Back in Time, and all these songs that I'd kind of written in Melbourne, and other ones that I'd written since then. This was about 1994, I'm guessing. And I remember it, I can still picture it. I can picture Eddie off in the corner with that look, that Eddie Rayner look. When he, you know, I can't describe it any better than that. And he came up to me after I'd played, and he went, "Are they all your songs. Because I'd met him at the Finn's place in Melbourne beforehand, you know, when I lived there, but I didn't really know him that well. And he seemed like a really cool guy, and I was such a huge fan of Split Enz, you know, so it was always a little bit nerve-wracking meeting those guys and hanging out with them. He came up to me after that party and said, well, look, I'm just setting up a little studio at Revolver Studios out in Royal Oak. He said, I reckon we should demo some of these songs. I'd really like to hear what you've done, because George Shushkoff, who had the studio, the main studio there, had given he'd said to Eddie, look, if there's anyone you want to record at the studio that you think might be worthwhile recording, we'll give you some studio time. So he said, I want to record you. So I went out to his little studio within the Revolver complex. And over the course of 2 or 3 days, we recorded like 60 songs. And half of them on the guitar, half of them on piano. He said, I want to hear everything you've ever written. So basically I just, wrote a list of all the songs that I could remember. And over the course of the next month, he just listened to all these songs in their basic form and kind of whittled them down to 30, got rid of all the rubbish songs. And then he whittled those 30 down to 20. And we ended up with 14 songs that we recorded. Two of those, after we'd recorded the rhythm tracks, we thought they're not quite what we thought they were going to be, so we ditched them. We actually re-recorded Nobody Else and Heartbroke. Because Ed just thought, they're great songs, they deserve to be on an album. But I felt really uncomfortable with them. I just thought, they were kind of rockier versions of those songs, and I just thought, I just didn't feel comfortable re-recording them. So they stayed off the album, and we ended up with those 10. It was a great time, I remember having to kind of pinch myself at times, I remember going in for Ed was doing a keyboard session and I just had to kind of pinch myself. There's Eddie Rayner playing keyboards on my album and producing my album. I don't think I've ever really thanked Eddie enough for what he did, because I don't think he ever got any money for it. He just did it. We had no record company interest whatsoever. We just did it because George Shushkoff, who owned Revolver, had said, look, let's do it. They own the album, basically. We eventually got some record company interest, because we shopped it to all the majors, Sony and EMI, and no one really knew what to do with me, I don't think. But we went to Warner's, and James Southgate at Warner's, who hadn't really been in this country for that long, probably didn't know a lot of my history. He heard it and thought it was fantastic. Eddie Rayner was really confused as well. He was like, why aren't these people falling over themselves? This is a great record with great songs. But Ed didn't know my history. He wasn't here when I had a number one hit, or when I did all that TV stuff, which really confused people when I got into TV. So James Southgate, who knew nothing about that history, heard the album and went, this is fantastic. And we did a licensing deal with them. I created my own label called Criminal Records, which I thought was pretty apt. So it was released on Warner's, on Criminal Records through Warner's, and it did absolutely nothing. It stiffed, and we were convinced that we had an album that was worthy of some chart action, and we had a bit of trouble with radio because the songs weren't rocky enough for Hariki, and they were too rocky for 1ZM. So we kind of started falling between the cracks. And we made Mark Tierney made a great video for the first single for World Stand Still. It was a very good video.
Smile to show. There's a little bit of misery in everyone. Can you see her? Go. She's coming to me loud in stereo. Left and right, dream and dream she only knows. In the morning she's still looking for a Romeo. Can you see her running? She has no fun in life. I can make you singing hymns to me every night, feeling guilty, feeling fine, but the lions won't touch you when it's feeding time. Oh no, I can make your world stand still. You just say the word, I will. I can make your world stand still. You just say the word.
We got a bit of radio play, and I think World Stand Still was in the charts for a week or a couple of weeks in the 40s, but it did nothing, and I got started to get really disillusioned. So unfortunately, you know, we released These Dark Moods as a second single, and John T. Rutherford did a video and stuff, and Warner's hated that video so much that they never sent it to TV.
Blown. I no longer have control.
So it was at that stage where I just went, that's it, I've had enough. When I decided that a life of a pop star was not for me, I thought I'd like to run a recording studio. I've always wanted to do that, and the opportunity came up to take over the studio at the Depot in Devonport here in Auckland. And so I kind of dived into that. It was going to be a corporate studio to start with, you know, jingles and TV themes and, you know, albums and stuff like that. But the way it kind of worked out was there was a generation of local kids in Devonport. And for whatever reason it happened, that all pretty much came through Takapuna Grammar. And some sensational musicians just came through that school and for some reason gravitated towards the studio to jam, to rehearse, to do demos and stuff like that. And I remember in 2000, I vividly remember this, getting a knock at the door. I was working on something, I can't remember what I was working on, and down at the studio. And there was this, just this beautiful young man in his Takapuna Grammar uniform with a guitar. And he said, "Hi, I'm Finn Andrews, and I write songs, and I really like to record some." And I went, "Cool, come in." You know? So we organised for him and his band to come in on the next Sunday, and I set up some mics, and they set up their gear and stuff, and I heard, you know, I was plugging a few mics and stuff in, and I heard this guy, this voice, off in the gallery, you know, he was warming up and he started to sing. He was 16, just. And I just thought, and I actually had to go out and have a look and see where that noise was coming from, you know, that beautiful sound. And anyway, cut a long story short, he, God Boy, cut a little demo over the course of the Sunday afternoon, and he just completely blew me away. From the second I heard him open his mouth to sing, I just thought, this guy's got something special. And it was so cute because he knew exactly what songs were going to be demoed and what order they were going to go in. And when I burnt the CD, he gave me one CD and he took one CD, and he'd printed two little CD sleeves. It was so sweet. And he put one in mine and one in his, and they kind of skipped out of the studio. And that night, I put it on at home, and he had credits and stuff on it, you know. And I'd really like to thank Shriekback and Mum and Dad. And I said, "Shriekback? Why Shriekback?" And then I put two and two together, and I thought, Finn Andrews, Barry Andrews. And I rang him and I said, "Your dad isn't Barry Andrews, is it?" "Yeah, he's my dad." "Yes." I went, "Oh my God, XTC, oh." So his dad is Barry Andrews, who I'm a huge fan of. So it's like, oh, the stars have lined up again. And anyway, over the next couple of years, I did a whole bunch of demos with Finn and tried to get a record deal for him. EMI here were really keen to sign him up, but he was determined to go back to London, and he left school and went back to London, and, you know, within 3 months had a deal with Rough Trade, and the Vales were born. And you know, the same thing happened with Gin Wigmore, exactly the same thing. 15-year-old came in and said, "Look, I'm, you know, my dad, God bless his soul, he's not with us anymore." Gin's dad was the local chemist, Wigmore's pharmacy here in Devonport. And she came in and the same thing, "I've got some songs and I'd really like to record them." And I just kind of put her in the room with a mic, and she had an acoustic guitar, and exactly the same thing happened, where she started to sing and it was like, where's that noise coming from? Out of this sweet little 15-year-old schoolgirl came this amazing voice with these amazing songs. And I knew it immediately that she was going to be a star. It was just so obvious. She had no idea at that stage, I don't think, just quite what she had. And in fact, the person that she was then and the person that she is now are so different. She was so shy and so, she was such a sweetie. She is still a sweetie, but she's like turned into this rock chick, and she's just got so much confidence and such a great performer. Everything she does goes to number one, you know. She's an incredible artist and a hard-working artist, you know. She works hard, she tours constantly, as do the Vales, hard workers. Same thing happened with the Czechs, you know, who are still, apart from the dudes in Hello Sailor, probably my favourite New Zealand band of all time. Just the greatest little rock and roll band. I remember I saw them in the supermarket, New World at Devonport. I didn't know who they were. They were just these scruffy young schoolboys in New World. And I actually remember going up to them and saying, you have to be in a band together. And they went, yeah, we're the Czechs from Takapuna Grammar. You know, they were probably 14 or 15, I don't know. They were young. But they just looked like a band, and they looked like cartoon caricatures of themselves. You know, it was just... And they say, oh, we're playing at the Masonic on Friday night. You should come and have a look. So I went down, and it was like watching The Faces in 1973, you know. It was just like, what the? I was completely blown away. And over the course of the next couple of years, you know, I did a lot of work with that band and ended up doing their sound. You know, they were like, oh, we're doing some gigs. You know, we don't know what PA we need. And I ended up, you know, kind of being their sound guy for a while. And, you know, I did a couple of big day outs with them, and Jin, you know, as their sound technician. There are other bands as well, like Whitebirds and Lemons and the Electric Confectioners, who I did a lot of work with. I just, you know, all these great bands that came through, the Early Birds, who I didn't do so much work with, but they were around as well. You know, all these fantastic artists. It was quite phenomenal, really. And later on, after I'd left the studio, I got approached by Scott McLaughlin at Universal to do some demos with this local young singer called Ella, who we all kind of knew was a great singer, because she'd kind of come up through, she's a couple of years younger than my daughter Gala, and had come up through Belmont Intermediate and Takapuna Grammar, and everyone knew this girl was a great singer. So anyway, cut a long story short, Universal were going to sign her up to a development deal, and I did some demos with her in my lounge. I had my studio in my lounge at that time. So the first things that she ever recorded, she recorded in my lounge. First time she'd ever done, and from what I can gather, the first time she'd ever heard herself sing. And it was kind of bizarre, because the rest is history. She became Lord. And it was bizarre, because 3 years, almost to the day that she did those demos, Janie, my current wife, and I were watching her receiving Grammys, you know, the Grammys in the same lounge as she'd been standing, you know, doing her first demos. It was kind of bizarre. And I remember actually crying and actually, you know, just thinking, just the enormity of it all, and just the amazingness of the music industry. It's like, again, you know, if you put your mind to it, anything can happen. You know, and I just remember being completely overwhelmed with pride, and, you know, like, not that I had anything to do with Lord's success, but just the enormity of that, you know, of her being this young 13-year-old doing her first demos, and 3 years later, as a 16-year-old, getting Grammys for a number one hit in America. You know, just unbelievable. And the same for Jin, you know, just, and Finn, and all those people that I kind of help. I'm not taking any credit for their success, but what I like to think I did was I pushed the boat out. You know, I just kind of encouraged them and gave them the opportunity, you know. And enormous pride, you know, whenever I see Finn perform or Jin or anyone like that, I just think, wow, I helped in some way. It was only a small part. And again, I would never, ever say that I have anything to do with their success, but I just gave them that little bit of encouragement that I think everybody needs, you know. Yeah, huge pride in that. The activity that used to make me feel alive when I was a kid was playing football. There was some, and even as I played football when I was an adult as well, and it was the same thing. It was hard to explain. It's like the world just kind of disappeared, and I was very much in a little bubble. I just loved football so much. I loved playing it so much. It made me feel very alive. these days, I think that feeling when I'm about to mix a show, there's something about that where you have, where you're kind of getting ready, and it's like 10 minutes before a show, and you, and I'm trying to get in the moment, and the enormity of it kind of strikes home, and the there's a lot of responsibility as a sound engineer at a live show, because everything's pretty much riding on you. I feel very much in the moment at that time, and I feel very, very alive, and you know, the heart starts to pound a little bit. It's a really nice feeling. So I think that's, these days, that's what makes me feel alive. In the pipeline for me is to record another album. That's a big one for me. I've said it every year for about 20 years. You know, my New Year's resolution is always, I'm gonna do an album, you know, I'm gonna do another album. And then I just get kind of waylaid with making a living, you know. And then I think, oh, who wants to hear it, you know? But now I'm at that point now where I've got so many songs that it's kind of like, I feel like it's really my legacy now to leave these songs, to leave them behind, you know. Not that I'm going anywhere, but you know what I mean. It's like, like most people go for a walk or a bike ride, I'll write a song, you know. I've never stopped writing songs. I write songs, you know, all the time. You know, I remember my dad ringing me when I lived in Sydney in 1986 or whenever it was, before Nobody Else happened. And I remember he said to me, he said, you're a effing dreamer. You're a dreamer, Rick. Get a real job, you know. And I just thought, I got really upset, you know. And I understand why he said it. He was caring for me, but it just made me even more determined. I never gave up, you know. And I think that's a really good thing to admit and to say, is that no matter how dark things can get, how down you can get, there's always hope, you know. There's always hope. With it, whatever you do in life, there's always hope. There's going to be another day where things can change, you know. And even now, it's how I live, you know. I wish I'd known when I was 18 years old just how fast life goes. I wish I could have grasped that, you know. Life goes really fast, and I'd say this to my children now, you know, especially now that, you know, my older children are in their 20s. I just found that time from, say, 30 to 50 just seemed to go in a blink of an eye. And yet, you know, I'm in my 50s now, and you know, things change as you get older. Yeah, I mean, I've jammed a lot of stuff into my life, but I just wish I'd spent a lot of my 20s doing very little, and I just kind of wish I'd, you know, known then what I know now. Just life goes really fast. Yeah.
I know I've acted badly in my life. I took you for granted, yeah. Well, that's no lie. But now I'm facing the future with a different role. Yeah, I'm working it out now, yeah. I just thought you should know I'll never leave, I'll never go, I'll never fly. Cause there's nobody else in my life now. No, there's nobody else comes within a country mile of you. There's nobody else on the side. No, there ain't, I know you'll never believe me when I say that I'm keeping my faith, girl, day by day by day. I'm immune to temptation. No, that ain't so. But it hasn't been easy, oh Lord. I just thought you should know. I'll never leave. I'll never go. I'll never fly. 'Cause there's nobody else in my life now. No, there's nobody else. Comes within a country mile of you. There's nobody else on the side. Oh no, there's nobody else. No, nobody else. There's nobody else. Nobody else. No, no, in my life. No, no, no. There's nobody else in my life now. Now there's nobody else. Comes within a country mile of you. There's nobody else. Nobody else. There's nobody. No, no, no. There's nobody else in my life now. No, there's nobody else. Comes within a country mile of you. There's nobody else. Nobody else. No, there ain't nobody else but you in my life.